Through steadfast devotion to the gods of fear, time, and money, humankind was led to manifest a world colored by scarcity, competition, and sorrow.
Okay, welcome everybody. Welcome to Simon on the Sofa. And you can probably see my my smile is beaming because I'm with a wonderful man that we've just been speaking for a couple of minutes. And as soon as I see him, actually, I have this nice warm feeling, and then we've just been laughing together. So welcome for the second time to Simon on the Sofa, Philip Shepherd. Hello, Philip. Welcome today. Thank you for joining me.
It's lovely to be here, as always. Yeah.
So it's lovely to have you. And if you didn't catch the first conversation that me and Philip spoke about, it's actually gone down as one of my personal favorites. So there's over 200 conversations or more now, but there's always some that just stick with me. And when I feel that there's a flow in the conversation, whatever, no expectations today, Philip, I'm just saying that it was one of my personal favorites. And really, because I remember we dived into just so many different topics about life and wholeness. And funnily enough, we spoke a lot about, I called the talk Radical Wholeness. And the reason being is for people watching, if this is your first time seeing Philip, his workshop is called Radical Wholeness. And his second book, which he's currently writing, is called Radical Wholeness. And he goes touring around the world, taking workshops and these beautiful events. And I'm going to say this for you, Philip, but inviting people into what it even means to be whole, what wholeness even means. Would that be a good description?
Couldn't have said it better myself. It is an invitation, exactly.
Yeah. And also what is lovely is I always just like to tell people I was attracted to Philip also because Philip is from a little bit from my own heart. He's an actor and has been an actor and a professional actor at that and been out there. And I don't know if you're still acting or if that sort of moved into more the sort of, I would say, the sort of transformative, I'm sure you're using your acting skills, but sort of self-empowerment work that you now do and for humanity, I'm going to go and say as well. But I don't know if is the acting still part of your life, Philip?
You know, it's like the universe is pulling me to share this work, and it's left no time for auditions or theater. And there is this part of me, this deep itch, this kind of roiling beneath the surface. So I'm so ready to jump into it again when opportunity avails itself.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
well, you know, it's funny because I can totally relate with you. So when I came out of, let's say, the acting profession and the industry as it was and so on, and the way I was viewing myself in the world, my perspective of acting and my drive for it, this need for fame and fortune, changed. However, I have friends that are filmmakers, I'm sure you have, and I still think that film and video is a phenomenal medium to tell stories. And one of the things that I'm really sort of got my views on is making, I've made an independent film myself, a couple of short movies and a feature, but I want to make a movie now based on the work that I now bring to the world. And I'm thinking maybe you just need to make your own film called Radical Wholeness, and put yourself in it, and there you go. You know, we're talking about a beautiful indie movie showing where we are in humanity.
Yeah. I'm really itching. I've kind of have this idea of a one-man show, and Andrew Harvey gave me the title for it, Journey to My Body.
Nice.
Talking, you know, going back to my childhood, all the pressures to disembody and how I found my way back into it, kind of this anecdotal visual thing. And what I miss about theater is that the presence of the audience and the lights and the space, it's like this lens that shows up every little impulse of life as it passes through you. And that's the joy of it for me. That's the part of it I miss.
Yeah, that's beautiful. So again, a one-man show. And you know, that would be beautiful to watch. And there is that essence, isn't it? That, like you said, the to perform and to bring through an authentic offering as an individual, as an expression, as an artist, there's not much that tops that. Yeah, I feel. Because like the work you're doing and the work that I do, I call it play with purpose. And I would like to maybe put yours in that that bracket, if you don't mind, as opposed to work. Because I feel yourself, Andrew Harvey, Jeff Brown, and you know many people that I speak to, like we really are in service to what evolution in the world wants to bring through. And Nate, I'd love you, just for the audience that are watching today, Philip, just could you give us a little encapsulation, like a couple of minutes of your story, if you will, a little bit of your life story, just for those watching. And I'd love you to just describe what your first book was about inside of that, if you can. Are you okay to do that? A little sort of, a nutshell you?
Yeah, I mean, I'm Canadian. I grew up on the cusp of suburbia and farmland. So I mention that because I spent my childhood outdoors. There was one street over, down at the end of the street was a horse farm. The other direction down at the end of the street was this spring-fed creek and frogs and wildlife. And I was entranced by the felt wonder of that space. And, I actually watched that space, this freshwater creek, I watched as the adults buried that spring-fed creek in a sewer and filled it up with lawn and houses. And there is today no trace of the magic that so deeply informed my childhood. And so I knew at a young age that adults were insane. And I grew more deeply into that realization, especially as a teenager, 15, 16, 17. I was actually in a rage much of the time because I could feel my being violated at every turn, violated by stale patterns of conversation, violated by precepts of conformity, and even in those days, precepts of nonconformity that were strenuously conformist. if you follow what I mean, right? And I could feel my thinking sort of being funneled down these well-worn grooves. And I fought it, and I fought it, but it's a little like standing in the ocean fighting the waves. You're going to go down, right? So I left. I went to England. I got a bicycle and headed off for Japan because I knew that as long as I stayed in my culture, I would never be able to ask the questions that would liberate me from these assumptions that had been seeded in my cells as a child. And I went through, I cycled through Europe and the Middle East and India and Japan. I went through so many different ways of understanding what it means to be human. Every culture is a story in its architecture, its clothes, its manners, its customs, is a story about what it means to be human. And every story I went through was luminous. And every story I went through was limited. And the first time I suffered culture shock was returning home. And suddenly it's like this world that it was, every brick of every house was familiar to me, and the whole thing just looked bizarre. And that, so I'd come back able to ask the questions I needed to ask. And those questions led eventually to New Self, New World, my first book. And what the book looks at is where we are today and how we got there in terms of our relationship to the body. And it's something I don't know anyone, I mean, the body, we don't give it a second thought in a historical vein. But when you look at our relationship to the body and how it's changed over millennia, you realize that our relationship to the body is the template for every relationship we have in the world. So our whole culture in the West is top down because we live in our heads, and that's our relationship. And even our breath is a top down phenomenon. You push, you know, it's well understood that it's important to breathe deeply, but we're pushing the breath down from the top, and that takes muscular effort, and the muscles get tired and the breath goes shallow again. It's just everything, our breath, our hierarchies, our relationship to nature, everything is stamped with this relationship we have with the body. So New Self, New World looks at that and begins to point to how, you know, how once that relationship with the body begins to shift, how you see the world around you shifts. That's why it's called New Self, New World, because as you drop out of the head, you drop your center of awareness down to come to rest in the pelvic bowl, suddenly you're in a completely different world. You're opening your eyes on a world of process and energy, rather than separate things and mechanics, which is what we tend to see in the head.
Yeah,
it wasn't maybe as short an encapsulation.
No, it doesn't matter. I was enchanted and captivated by the story. And I remember you. I'm always fascinated by your story of just getting on a bike and going on that journey. And you know, to some extent, we all go on our own. Well, not to some extent, we all go on our own hero's journey. And that, you know, yours is a beautiful one in that. And what I like is that how you are a storyteller and you are a you've put yourself in that the realms of theatre and storytelling in you know, even in the from an acting perspective, and now you're very much a storyteller in what I like to call the real life movie, and that's the real life movie of humanity and evolution and where we are and how we as individuals can contribute to that story and what we can do in order to make a difference in the world or to show up and make changes that we might want to see. And I feel that that's very much what you've done. You've definitely, I don't want to call it the false world, because some people would say it's all an illusion on some level or a false world. But acting is acting, you know, you're putting on a character, you're putting on a costume, you're embodying another being, and then you're performing that. Whereas at the moment, I feel, and I think your friend Andrew Harvey calls it sacred activists, right? He uses the word sacred activists. So with that in mind, with this sort of fully exploring the body and going in and looking at the body like you just described and looking at the, you know, the conformity and the agreements that we didn't agree to and the conditioning and so on, I think it'd be lovely. Or where I feel at the moment, Philip, is you've got like these two, this transition of, let's just call it two worlds for the conversation. And maybe the sense of this new self that you're talking about and this new world is emerging. And how we can do that inner work with ourselves. Like we can make it have an impact on the outer world by doing the inner work. So maybe with what you've uncovered with radical wholeness and the work you've been doing in your workshops, I'd love you to talk about that. Is that how you see it now, from that dropping maybe deeper into yourself, deeper into that essence of your body? How is that? I'd love to know the way you view the world now.
You're ready. I know exactly what you mean by the two worlds. I frame them slightly differently.
Super.
So going back to the bike ride, one thing I rarely talk about is the amount of time I spent alone outside. And I didn't have a tent. I had a sleeping bag, because a tent's got this characteristic where everyone knows where you are and you don't know where anyone else is. So I just slept under the stars everywhere I went. And there was this quality of feeling the present with an attunement to an intelligence that could not be grasped, but could be felt. And I'd head off on my bike every morning having no idea where I would be sleeping that night. No idea what was around the next corner. And the time came, and every night I would be guided to a place to sleep that was safe. And I could feel that guidance. So those two worlds you talk about, to me, what most distinguishes them is that you can either feel the present and find guidance there, or you defer to your ideas about the present and run on those. And I think, you know, for my money, the most dangerous people in the world are those who feel their ideas about the present more keenly than they feel the present. Mm. So to come back to the body, to me, is to come back to the present. Mm. The head, you're living in the head, you've got all these ideas, you're like in a hamster wheel up there, and it's like a closed system. So that inner work you speak of is part one. I guess, to me, the body is like a bell. It's like a resonator, and it resonates to the present. It feels it and rings to it. But what we've done in our culture, we've basically stuffed the bell full of cotton balls. Mm. And right, it doesn't ring. So the inner work, to me, is about finding the obstructions and liberating them, just one by one, integrating them so that that bell is clear. And then suddenly, you know, when the bell is clear of those cotton balls, the present exists. When it's full of the cotton balls, what are you talking about, guidance of the present? So what are you talking about, this bell rings? It doesn't, right? Mm. So that inner work, how to find the obstructions in the body, the obstructions to the breath, the muscle patterns that you're not even aware of, the emotional, the emotions that haven't been integrated, all of those things are held in the body's tissues. And any chronic tension, any pattern or deadening of the body is a form of resistance to the present. Mm-hmm. And we're so stuck with our head-centric culture. We're so stuck on owning our ideas and thinking with the head that we're not available to what I call the decentralized thinking of truly being in the present.
Mm. Beautiful. Wonderful. So when you was talking, you were saying the emotions and these emotional addictions and these survival emotions that we've become so addicted to has been something that's been very at the forefront of my own, you know, exploration recently, or exploration of consciousness, and this sort of depending on maybe what, I guess I'm in a very privileged state. I'm very blessed and grateful to be able to ponder reality and to, you know, sit for hours on my own and explore who I am and what the world's doing. I know many people in the world don't have that that privilege for whatever reason, maybe their own lack and limitations that have led them into those spaces. So as you're speaking, I get this sense that, and I'd love to hear your views on this, is, you know, we have this like mystery, we're in this mystery, yeah? It's just a full-on mystery. We're dancing with the unknown, and we're out there finding our way, and, you know, we're meeting people, and there's reflections and the mirrors, and we get to see ourselves, and we get to explore who we are, and, you know, we get to explore love and, you know, consciousness and all these other good, you know, beautiful things, these adventures, anger, fear, the shadow, the emotions. We get it all, right? We just get it thrown at us, full power. And even now, the youth coming into the world, you know, they're getting this, like, they're coming into such a different world now of information and technology and, you know, just, it's all there, you know, everything's there at a tap of a button. It's just information overload. And when we come back to the present, and I want to keep on the thread of what you just beautifully described, and we're in this present moment, and we have this sense of guidance and awareness, and all this other stuff drops away, And almost as you described being on your journey with the bike, it's like you each moment you're in the unknown, but within that unknown, there's like a knowingness, a guidance, a support, a real, you know, almost like a care, and you're tapping into an intelligence that is always there, because you're playing with that. So one of the things I feel is that we've got so clouded up in our head, in our headspace, in our thinking and so on, that to even be present, so for example, for even to sit for an hour and just sit in silence is so difficult for us. Yeah, so difficult, I say for me, and using that as an experience, it was so difficult for me until I practiced and practiced and practiced. So when we talk about this new world and we talk about these new ways of being, do you see it that regardless, like whatever happens, consciousness is becoming more present in order for us to survive as a species? Or is it irrelevant of this so-called human species, and it's like that's just where, like that's just an option that we will always have? Like there's always been some people that are present and more connected and more maybe in coherence with their body, and there's always people that are just out of coherence, and that's always the case. Am I making sense in what I'm pointing to? It's like, is it like, are we being called as a collective that we could all become present, engaged, self-embodied, you know, illumined, awakened, you know, dancing in the spontaneity? Is that a calling for the whole of humanity, or is that just for just whoever wants to explore it?
I mean, the crisis that we feel, and it's just overwhelming to feel the particulars of it. My daughter studied environmental science and every day learned the reality of what's happening to the planet. And it was just emotionally devastating for her. So the crisis, I think, is calling to us all. No one can go it alone. And what it's, if I can speak from my own perspective as deeply as I can, it's calling us to wholeness. Now, we've misunderstand what wholeness is in our culture, because we think wholeness is something contained within a boundary. I can talk about, you know, the wholeness of my thermos or the wholeness of myself. And if I want to be whole, I just seek to be whole and body, mind, and spirit, and arrange those aspects of myself, and there I am whole. And it's nonsense. Wholeness doesn't have a boundary. Wholeness doesn't exclude anything. My wholeness does not stand independent of this room, of the rain outside my window. It hasn't an outer fringe. And to say the world is calling us to wholeness is to recognize at the same time the ways in which we have desensitized our ability to feel wholeness. So when you talk about the guidance of the present, you feel that guidance from a place of wholeness. If you're up in your head chasing your ideas, you're blind to it. Mm-hmm. So we have blinded ourselves as a culture to wholeness on the one hand. On the other hand, wholeness is the only reality.
Right.
Everything depends on everything. Everything is in process with everything. Nothing stands independent of the whole. So to be blind to wholeness is to be blind to reality.
Right.
And then you're chasing a fantasy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So actually, that's really lovely. And thank you for that, you know, clarifying that on my long-winded dive into that. Because actually, if it's already whole, because that's what you're saying, there's no boundaries. So to some extent, it's already whole, right? That's what we're saying. And it's already complete, even in the so-called perspective of seeing incompleteness, or that's wrong, or this is wrong, or that shouldn't be like that, or whatever. Whereas if what we're talking about, or what's coming up for me in this moment, is that what shifts is our perspective to what we're actually seeing outside of ourselves. Because we're looking outside of ourselves, judging it as like, you know, it shouldn't be a war there. This environment shouldn't be crumbling here. The whales shouldn't be getting killed here. The sharks shouldn't be getting killed here, and so on and so forth. And, you know, child abuse shouldn't be happening. Sex trafficking shouldn't be happening. And so we find ourselves in this big resistance and conflict to what is, which goes back to actually what you began the conversation with, is the minute you're in conflict to what is, you're out of the present, right? Because you're playing with an idea. You're playing with an idea of how it should be rather than how it is. Yeah. So within that, though, there's the wholeness. So is it just a case of, okay, we just accept what is, and then there's, you know, there's not much left to act, do? No, I see you shaking your head. Exactly.
Two things. One is to realize that you are whole, that you don't achieve wholeness. Right? You don't master it. You don't strive to attain it. You're whole. The only thing is you don't realize it because you've desensitized yourself to it. So wholeness, rather than being something you achieve for yourself, it's something you surrender to, which brings us back to Joseph Campbell's definition of the hero, which is the man of self-achieved submission. And that's a submission to what is. Now, as you surrender to your wholeness, you begin to attune like a bell to the world around you, and it will ignite you. Mm-hmm. Because you have been born with this unique cluster of gifts that the world has never seen before, and the world will call to those gifts. And then you either answer or you don't. Mm. And if you answer, you answer no holds barred. You answer that call, and the whole of your life comes into focus because of that attunement to the present and what it's calling you forth, calling forth from you. Mm. And
go on, carry on, please.
So the world. The world is always harmonizing. That's what the present is. The present is the work of harmonizing. We can join that work of harmonizing only through our wholeness. So we are trying to solve the world's problems from a partial intelligence, an enclosed intelligence that only knows control and doesn't know harmony. And it even thinks of control and harmony as being almost synonymous. And in fact, they're opposites, right? So it's only through that surrender to the body, to the present, to the harmony of what is, that you can begin to participate in the work it's doing. You'll never get there from the place of control. And that underscores one of the deepest assumptions in our culture that lives in the cells of our bodies. And that assumption is knowledge will save us. And we live with that on a personal level. Like, oh, I just have to read this book. This Facebook post is so great. I know that. And we're on this insatiable hunger feed of information and facts and knowledge. And all you have to do is like cast an eye kind of idly back through history to see that knowledge is lethal. Just for starters, knowledge, every problem we face today has been generated by our knowledge of how to burn fossil fuels, how to make plastic, how to build machinery, how to, you know, go into agribusiness and feed more and more people, how to deplete the earth. So if knowledge could save us, we'd be in much better shape now than we were 2,000 years ago as a species. And we've pushed ecosystems to the breaking point. So knowledge is lethal unless it's countervailed by self-knowledge.
Yeah, because I was just about to throw in there. So if knowledge got us to that point, can knowledge get us back? Or not back to the next step?
Well, what's lacking is self-knowledge, and we don't know what self-knowledge is because we don't know what wholeness is.
And because we haven't looked deeper within ourselves, which is where the intelligence is in trying to communicate to us constantly right here. We've been going outside of ourselves to seek knowledge, as opposed to going inside of the body or to access the body awareness that you were speaking about earlier. Is that what you're pointing to?
I would say it differently.
That's okay. Go on.
Because I think the most important thing is to go outside of yourself, but not, you see, there are these two, those two worlds you spoke of earlier. The one world is seeking known relationship, and it's attached to ideas and believes in their power. And the other world is a world of felt relationship. And they're entirely different things. You know, I can know my relationship to the thermos, or I can feel my relationship to the thermos. And by feeling it, I'm dropping into the body and attuning in some way to it.
Yeah. So we're talking about feeling. You're saying, what's the first one? You're talking about feeling and thinking.
There's known relationship and felt relationship.
Yeah, and known relationship is not from feeling. Known relationships from thinking, from intellect, from thinking like, you know, I got this. And felt relationship is obviously from feeling, truly sensing, receptivity.
Being present
to
it.
Being and being as opposed to doing or going or whatever other ing.
So for me, the realm of self-knowledge isn't found by going inside. I go inside to clear out the obstructions, critical, crucial work. But once the obstructions are cleared, I can come into felt relationship. And as I come into felt relationship with a kid playing on the sidewalk, who I am is illuminated. As I come into relationship with a tree, like felt relationship with a tree, who I am is illuminated. The more deeply you come into felt relationship with the world around you, the more deeply who you are is illuminated by the world.
Right.
And
right.
Self-knowledge, to me, only derives from that experience of being in true felt relationship.
Yeah, but and it's lovely, lovely described. And also simultaneously, there's a paradox, isn't there? Because there's that essence of, as always, I call it the funky paradox, because there's that sense of going within. Because there's a saying that I have, and I'm by no means holding on to any, because I believe all belief is flawed. So belief for me is flawed. Yeah, it's like man-made belief is flawed on some level. That's how
it's always incomplete.
It's always incomplete. Exactly. So when I say go within, I have this saying, go within or go without. So the sense of going within, I'm going in to look at my inner state of, like you said earlier, that you know what I'm addicted to, my beliefs, my subconscious programming, and all them other agreements and all that other cotton balls that are stopping my bell from ringing. Yeah, that's what we're talking about. And so by going in and doing that inner work, and now at the moment I've been looking into that on another level, because I used to call it, I still do call it the pain body, the emotional wounds, the shadow. It's called many different things in our society, our culture now. And then really looking at these survival emotions and then seeing on a biological and a neuroscience perspective how the body functions when we're having a survival emotion, you know, when we're having a response to a survival emotion or whether we're having a response to an elevated emotion. So I'm looking even deeper into the blind spots within myself to see what energy is driving certain thought forms and beliefs. Because my exploration as a explorer is that if thoughts really create reality, and then there's a beautiful man out there sharing insights now into neuroscience and so on called Dr. Joe Dispenza, and somebody I've been looking into recently and reading on and watching a lot of his content. And I love what he said is that if you really, truly believed that thoughts create your reality, what did you do today to consciously create your future, right? What thoughts did you actually give life and what thoughts did you actually choose to put energy behind, elevated emotion behind, and then birth into the, you know, the collective consciousness, this like pool of the quantum field. Or so the reason why I bring this in is that for me, that inner work of like really, I call it inner surgery, of dissecting all of that stuff and getting those blockages and resistances and false beliefs out, almost opens me, it like literally feels like it opens me to become this channel beyond me to plug into an intelligence that is like not me. And you know, there's no me almost. It's like there's no me. There's almost like no Simon. There's no human. There's just then this connection. And maybe you're calling this like felt connection to the magic, the awe, the wonder, and everything it is. And like you can literally feel that you're a part of everything. I don't know if I'm describing myself well here, but even the words that describe things seem to limit it and block me from engaging with it in a very deeper essence. You know, if I call that a tree, it almost blocks me from feeling what that really is. Or if I say that boy, I've already put that boy into the bracket of the boy, and it blocks me from the felt experience that might be there beyond the boy. Is that making any sense at all?
Yeah, language is taking you into known relationship. And the body is taking you into felt relationship.
Right.
May I talk about ants for
Please.
A minute?
Bring in the ants, man.
Bring in the ants. So there's this amazing woman, Deborah Gordon, who for 30 years has gone to the same little patch of desert in Arizona to study the same ant colonies. And she's completely rearranged our whole understanding of how an ant colony works. You know, we know the queen is in charge of the colony. No. In fact, no ant can ever tell another ant what to do. And the colony operates with this supreme intelligence. And the individual ants are butt stupid. Like just like she'll talk about watching two ants like pull back and forth on a twig, and she'll go have a cup of tea and come back, and they're still pulling like they're in the same colony, and one's pulling this way like what, right? There's no, and yet the colony, there are these strange things. Like she talks about sitting watching a colony, and it was just where the summer monsoons were starting to gather. And ants started to build, a little group of them started to build a turret around the entranceway to the ant colony. There weren't too many ants building it, or it could never have been built. There were just enough. And it was built, and the rains came, and the colony didn't flood. Now, how was that decision made? No ant is like making a decision. Every ant is guided by the emergent intelligence of a colony, an intelligence that doesn't exist. You can't find it at the level of the individual
ant. It's invisible.
It's like the field that you spoke of. You get enough ants together, like I think the number is around 30, and the field starts to appear.
Right.
Before that, it doesn't exist. And every ant is guided by the field. No ant can objectively know the field. No ant can understand the field. No ant can see the field, but it's guiding their every move.
Phenomenal.
Now, you'd think, with the number of people on this planet and the life on this planet, that there would be a field available to us. And to me, that's what you're talking about.
Yeah.
We cannot see it.
Yes.
We cannot objectively understand it. We can't dissect it or analyze it, but we can feel it.
Yeah.
So that part of us that wants to come into an own relationship will forever be blind to it, because it's bringing inappropriate tools to the task.
Right.
The part of us that is willing to feel, that is willing to open the body up to what is there and let it ring you,
right,
that part will feel that emergent intelligence.
Right, there you go. And actually, there's a beautiful thing that you cannot enter this field as a somebody, a something, somewhere, in some time. You have to be nobody, nowhere, no time, no thing, no essence. You have to be nothing to even enter that field, to even be able to, to influence the field, really, on some level. And simultaneously, that field is being affected because it has all intelligence, all everything, all it happening all at once at all times. So even if you're creating a reality that is so-called negative, bad, you don't like it, it's going all, you know, wrong, pear-shaped, you're still creating that. You are the grand creator of the reality, which comes back down to this essence again of the wholeness, knowing that you're complete, knowing that you're a miracle, knowing that you are already enough. Sort of seems to drop away all of this other identity, ideas, these theories, these concepts, these opinions of who we may think or think we are or think we're not. Which I don't know. I'm taking this from you. What you're saying is that then that enables us to feel. It's the same in sexuality. It's been happening for me recently. It's like the more that I do nothing and let go and just feel and work on breath and feeling, I'm doing nothing, it would seem, in the old way of making love, of, you know, going for the outcome, looking for some result, and, you know, seeking ejaculation and all this other stuff. And in the minute I do nothing, I feel exponential sensitivity, beyond sensation, right? It's like the same thing, you know? It's like, it's this letting go, or I don't know, this is just maybe in my unfolding. It's like this letting go fully, surrendering fully, dropping out of everything fully, in order to access maybe this wholeness. Or that's what's coming up for me. It's like you can't access this wholeness thinking, like you said earlier, that this is it, or I'm going to go there, or I'm going to be whole.
Yes. It's all made clear once you look at the question, what is your experience of reality? And we are trained to think, oh, what is my experience of reality, to contract our awareness in order to understand that. But for my money, my experience of reality is my experience of the world passing through me. Now, I buy an apple and I swallow it, and that apple becomes eyelashes and capillaries, and the part of the apple I don't need passes out of me to nourish the apple tree. I take a breath and I'm taking the out-breath of trees into my body, and it becomes my body and passes out again to nourish the trees. You meet someone on the street and you feel their energy pass through you. And you can also choose to brace against that energy. If you do that, you're diminishing your experience of the world passing through you, and you are diminishing your sense of reality. It becomes like slightly disconnected, slightly abstract. And that larger energy of the world, when there's a real porosity of the self, that energy flows through you and imparts to you your sense of reality, of being here now. Mm-hmm. And so to understand, I mean, that's back to wholeness, right? To understand that if I want to come back to connection, if I want to come back to a sense of my own reality, then it starts with the body and clearing it out so that I can actually experience the world passing through me in all the ways that it does.
And in that, there's only you, right? There's only you. So as you were saying that there's only the experience that I'm having. Like, I am the way, you are the way. There's only that the experience of reality has to be unique for each of us, right? It can't Absolutely. It can't be the same. Like, you know, that level of awareness that, of what you're seeing and saying, and how the apple creates the capillaries and creates the eyelashes, you know, some won't be experiencing reality like that. Some are experiencing reality just dense and in conflict and resistance, and hence why their actions and behaviors get created from that space of awareness. And then your actions and my actions get created from another unique, different stage of awareness. So as we're diving into this, with this little dance that we're having, right, just throwing different little views in and concepts, and it's lovely. Like, when I say to you, like, what do you feel in your perspective of reality, your experience of reality, Philip, as like, and where you've got to in your journey? What do you know? Like, what do you know you know?
Let me answer this way. There are things we want, like harmony, like peace of heart, like the wildness of passion, like the ability to rest completely in the body, in this place now. Joy. There are all these things we want, and we are instructed to self-achieve them. All of those qualities belong inherently to the present. The present is always at rest. The present is always in harmony. The present is utterly at peace. The present is untamably wild. If you join the present, you partake in those qualities that can never belong to you, but can be so deeply experienced that they just move your life like a leaf down a river. It's just,
yeah.
I feel that guidance, and when I close off from the present, I lose its qualities. When I open to the present and land there, I'm landing in its peace. I'm landing in its joy. There is in every leaf, in every fuzzy caterpillar, there is a joy of being that is expressed, just of being. And that's there if I can unlock my heart and my body and join the present.
Yeah, so as you're speaking then, so with that depth of presence that we're now pointing to and have arrived at, and like you said, to some extent, do we ever leave that if it's always whole? Do we ever leave that present state? Or again, does it come back to that, what you said earlier, just to tap into this? Because one of the things that comes up as you're speaking, so we spoke about, you know, your daughter, and she's at that thing, and it's that emotional thing of seeing how we've, you know, depleted resources, et cetera, et cetera. And we see this, we're always having this duality dance with suffering and, you know, the depths of darkness and so on. But even within that, are we saying that that isn't present? So like when somebody's in that state of real, let's say, depression or anger or violence or, you know, ignorance, whatever the word is that we want to use, are they out of present? Because I give you an example. When I'm in my pain body, when I'm triggered, when I am, you know, feeling disconnected and separate and stubborn and resentful and judgmental, I don't feel very present. I don't feel very connected to the magic and the awe and the wonder. I feel in a very, you know, secluded and dense and rigid and restricted space. And it's almost difficult to plug in to the presence. So, you know, is that what, just, yeah, speak to that if there's something coming up.
So that space of resentment and depression and anger, whatever that may be, what characterizes every one of those experiences is that you feel alone. You feel alone when you're depressed. You feel alone when you're angry. And what that tells me is that your experience of reality is diminished, because reality is wholeness.
Right.
So you have arrested that experience of reality passing through you. You are holding on to something because you don't know how to ground it. You don't know how to process it. Our culture tells us to process these things by thinking about them.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we get so stuck, and you'll never process. Yeah. So to me, the essence of there's this resource. It's like the human blueprint was printed, and there's this resource in the basement, but we've never opened the door. It's like cobwebs on the handle, and that realm is the pelvic bowl, and the pelvic bowl, the intelligence that rests in the pelvic bowl. And there's a brain there. There's an independent brain in the pelvic bowl, but there's an intelligence that other cultures know intimately that has a genius for integration, that knows how to ground us, that comes into felt relationship. To me, that's where that happens, is exactly. The pelvic bowl. It's where you land. We don't know how to land in the body. Where do you land? In the heart? Where do you land? To me, you land on the perineum, you land on the pelvic floor. Yeah. When you totally come to rest in the body, this floor, in the present, that's where you come to rest.
And when you breathe into that space as well, carry on, go on, I cut you off, carry on.
No. Yeah, I mean, the breath is crucial. Yeah. And again, you know, your gesture, when you breathe into that space, I would, instead of the top down, which I was talking about,
bottom up.
It's like if you find the pelvic floor.
Yes.
The pelvic floor, if you feel the out-breath and your awareness is on the pelvic floor, you'll feel the pelvic floor support the out-breath. And then there's that moment where you're ready for the in-breath. You just release the pelvic floor. Mm. And suddenly your breath is filling the body from the bottom up. Mm. And you feel the pelvic floor fill with the breath, and you feel it engage to support the in-breath as it drops. And then from that engaged place, you release to the out-breath. Mm. So as the pelvic floor releases to the in-breath and releases to the out-breath, it invites the whole of the body to release to the in-breath, release to the out-breath. And every time the body releases to the breath, it is releasing to the present.
Exactly. Because the breath, whenever we breathe, and if anybody's watching this, you will know, I've said this on many a conversation, when you breathe, if you just take a few moments to breathe, you become present. You just take some deep breaths in. What I love about this is that, for me, presence, breath is life. Everything's breathing. The universe is breathing. The trees are breathing. Everything is breathing. And when you come into that, what you said, the pelvic, the perineum, and you breathe there, you breathe with all of life. And when you breathe with all of life, you can't harm it. You plug yourself into such a love, such a magnificence, such a wonder, you're so connected. There's no loneliness in that place. You couldn't be lonely if you even tried in that place. And it's like, you know, when you plug in there, it's like, boom, it's ecstasy 101, bloody 3006, you know, whatever you want to call it. And this is what I'm always saying. This is the real, what's beautiful is we're going through the dance of the intellect and the mind and the questioning, and it brings it back to the simplicity. You've brought it back, and you did from the beginning. And to some extent, did we need the conversation? We could have just said this from the beginning. Nevertheless, I love.
But we would have missed all the fun.
Yeah, I love the dance, the inquiry, the dynamic, you know, difference of energies dancing with each other to get to that point. Which I'm telling you, Philip, it's like you, many other beautiful messengers out there, myself, and you know, that it's all coming back to exactly what you just described, that breath, the body, the perineum, the connection to all that is, the felt state. I love this.
So there's one other little context.
Good.
I'd love to offer to frame that. We need orientation in our lives. You know, just as a sailor needs the pole star. And there are so many ideals that you can choose to guide you forward, whether it's compassion or peace of heart or service or loving kindness. And they're all luminous and brilliant. And each one of them carries a tacit risk. And that risk manifests in the moment where you're in a situation, say compassion is your ideal. You're in a situation, say, oh, I should be compassionate here. And as soon as that happens, you're in a divided place. There's a part of you that knows what compassion looks like, know how it manifests, and it sort of makes sure the rest of you complies with its idea of what compassion is. There's one ideal that sidesteps that for me, which is wholeness. You can't achieve wholeness the way you can make yourself be compassionate or make yourself peaceful. You can't. It's already there. All you can do is surrender to it. So if you're moving into wholeness, you're moving into accord. You're moving out of division. And when I land in wholeness, I can be no other than compassionate. I'm completely at peace. That's what wholeness is. It's that rest within the currents of life. How could I practice anything other than loving kindness? So all of those ideals of courage and truth, they just happen.
You're not thinking about making them happen. It's like it's the byproduct of. It is what it is. You step into that, you do it. It's like, you know, it's doing you, if anything.
You can
say, you know, it's doing you. In fact, you get yourself out of the way, or it feels like for people listening, you get yourself out of the way. It's not even an intellectual thing, and it pours through you.
Yeah, it's like you may have these plans and you drop into wholeness and suddenly, oh, the world tugs you somewhere else, and it just tugs you, and you go because that's your life.
Yeah,
that's your path to wholeness.
Yeah.
You never. I mean, the nice thing about wholeness, you know, you can arrive at compassion and express compassion. You never get to wholeness.
Right.
You never wake up one morning and say, "Oh, finally, I'm whole. What next?" Yeah. I mean, it's a process, the same way that healing. I mean, you never get to heal completely healed. Cells are dying off with every breath and dividing. It's the process.
Yeah. So it's actually surrendering to the evolutionary process, the evolutionary impulse of life itself, of actually surrendering to. What you said earlier, this is coming up now, but like surrendering to the unknown, surrendering to what you don't need to know. Yeah, it's like you don't need to know. You can't know. You can't know. You said that earlier. You can't know it because you're it. So it's like you're kind of insane. We're trying to know that which we are, and we go outside of ourselves to try and remember what we are. We don't remember what we are. I get lost, kill people, wipe out loads of stuff, come back and realize, man, I can't find it. You was it all along.
and what's interesting too, in that surrender, you know, you can never say what being is, but you look at nature and you realize being loves diversity. There are no two blades of grass
no butterfly, no cell.
And nature loves service. Nothing is born that is not born to serve. I mean, a swallow flying in the night sky is in service. That swallow is weaving the world into wholeness. And nature loves change. There's the moment, same moment, never arrives again. It's exactly. Gone.
Yes.
And these three things, diversity, service, change, are the very things that when you live in your head, you resist.
Well, yeah, just going to throw in this in there quickly, diversity, service and change. Why is it that human, the why is always the damn why and the inquiry, humans resist change. And there's no such thing for me as humans, but nevertheless, this concept of humans resist change like it's going out of fashion. Judge diversity. You know, that's where bloody slavery and everything comes from, right? Diversity. And service, it's like, what can I get? Not what can I give? It's like service if you pay me, you know, I'll give you a good service if you pay well. It's like those three, why have they become so, just to end this conversation, I know we've done our beautiful hour, but like what, there is no answer to this, but why is it that those three have become so absent from us as nature's being? You know, we're supposed to be nature as well, natural selves. Anyway, I know this is a longer conversation, but if you want to pop a...
Well, let's just offer this, that wholeness, when you're guided, when you're present, and that tug happens, you're always being called into service.
Yes.
You're always
yes.
being called into newness, the diversity, yes. the change, yes. that yes. life. The world of ideas, which is the known relationship, ideas are static. We build a construct of reality. We represent reality with our ideas, and we think that that construct will enable us to navigate reality and will keep us safe. And so we live not in wholeness, but in a fractured world. And we feel ourselves a fractured piece of it. Mm. And then we look out for ourselves. Forget service. I need to survive
exactly.
here. Change is bad because it might threaten my
fear.
My construct. Diversity, it's like the immune system. Oh, that's other. I need to protect myself
yeah.
from it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so it's just this reactive... It's at its heart, it's the choice between the tyrant and the hero. The hero, as I said, is the man of self-achieved or the woman of self-achieved submission. The tyrant is the man of self-achieved independence. And you think of that phrase, Simon, self-achieved independence, that is the American dream. We have wedded ourselves to an idea of success that is the tyrant's fantasy.
Mm, the separate self.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry.
Well, you look, I mean, the very notion of independence is a fantasy.
Mm.
Show me an instance of independence somewhere in the universe. It does not exist.
Yeah.
Everything leans on everything. Everything is bound by fields of electromagnetism and gravity and consciousness.
Yes.
And there is no it's a fantasy, and it's the fantasy that we chase.
Yes, exactly. And we chase after so what I'm hearing is we chase after the illusion driven by fearness, not through wholeness, but through fearness. And it's coming through, and it has been for whatever reason. We don't need to give it reason. We just need to know that this idea of separation, this idea that we're alone, that we're not interconnected, this idea that fear is driving the ship, that the pain, the emotional wounds are leading us, and that's our natural state of being, is obsolete. That story is obsolete. And I think, you know, your book talks about it. Charles Eisenstein writes about it. Jeff Brown writes about it. Many, many people write about it. Even neuroscience is driving towards that now. You know, ancient texts of 2,000 or more years have pointed to, you know, those paths of wholeness, union, if you want to call it, and so on. So what's really beautiful for me, and I'm going to let you throw that in there. What's really beautiful? No, throw it in there first. Go on, drop it in there. Joe, go.
Well, I just like to say that. My take on it is that illusion of separateness is created by a relationship with the body.
Mm.
You cannot exchange one idea for another. You can't say, oh, I'm not separate, I'm whole, and it's underpinned by the experience of separateness, which happens when you're locked in your head. It's only as you change your relationship with the body that you wake up to the reality of self-relation.
No, and that's it, because the answer is here. It's in this body. The answer is here. You are the answer.
Yes.
Yeah? It's like, that's the whole point. You are the answer. So when we look in the body, we cut it open, we look how it works, it shows interdependence. It shows wholeness and connection. It is complete. It's right there. And the funny thing is, guess what? This is so crazy, because there's been so much outward suffering, but it's staring us in the face in the mirror. Isn't it?
Yes.
It's saying, look, I'm here. And you go, I'm off. It's over there, you know? I'm going to shoot that guy because he looks dodgy and he's after something.
Yeah.
And when you break this down and you dance with this and you look at the simplicity and the majesty and the wonder of it, I mean, how you can even harm that wonder, how you can harm that awness, how you can even contemplate. Well, this is the thing. When you actually breathe deeper and connect all facets of the self, there is no even consideration of harm. It doesn't exist. It just this does not exist.
Because the world would never guide you there.
No.
It just never would.
No.
So you either hang on to your, I call it centripetal thinking. The thinking that, there's centrifugal force and centripetal. The centripetal thinking that just contracts and tries to figure it out, or that dilation of thinking into that decentralized attunement to the world.
And it's open, isn't it? It's expansive. It's letting go. It's just like, wow. Let's surrender, like you've said throughout this call. What did you say earlier? It was surrendered. What was the
self-achieved thing? Submission.
Yes, that's the submission. Yes, self-achieved submission. You submit, you allow. And it's almost like, it's a saying I say sometimes, just to put this out there for people listening to break it down as well. It's just like dying before you die, almost. There's no death in this place. There's no death in what you're speaking today. It's like what we've just danced with. It's like wholeness can't die. It never grew. It won't die. It's so
always
magical.
Transforming, always transforming, never stopping.
No. Wow. Vast. It's only, you have to laugh. You have to laugh. Otherwise, you go crazy. Thank you.
Such a joy, son.
Yeah. Thank you for just dancing with me.
Nowhere I'd rather be, I can tell you that.
Yeah, thank you. So blessed. Yeah. I'm so grateful. So grateful. And beyond the form, when I met you the first time, I had this same feeling, and it's just that it really is beautiful. I know I haven't seen you or spoke to you for a long time, but that our connection in the field is such a gift. So I hope that people watching today, the beautiful people out there who are watching us today and dedicated their precious moments of life force to come and be with us, I want to thank you, because I had an hour today with this beautiful man. We've gone over a little bit, but that doesn't matter because time is illusion. You're going to go off now and continue writing your book, because I know you're in the writing phase. And I just, I'd love to come back together, as I always say, and when the time brings us, maybe when this second book is even launched, then we can do a little talk on that. But personally, I think this is even just a great invitation. So I'm just going to say this, Philip, for anyone watching, please head over, links as always below this talk, and just go over and have a look at Philip's first book and the second book, which will be coming out soon. And just dive in. And I know that if you have any questions, feel free to fire them over to either one of our websites and just ask away and have a conversation around it yourself. Strike up these conversations and explore, question everything and assume nothing. Is there anything, anything you'd like to say, Philip, to the people watching and who in who journeyed with us, or any last words before you head off?
Okay, one last word.
One.
That if we're moving into out of known relationship and the stasis of that, and into felt relationship and the life of that, the quality that most deeply brings us into felt relationship is gentleness. And to be gentle with your breath, gentle with your body, gentle with the things you use, the people you interact with, that will usher you into the magic and riches and wonder of living in felt relationship. Mm.
Beautiful. I might call this talk gentleness.
Mm.
Yeah. Radical gentleness.
Yeah. Because radical means rooted. So
yes.
Well, that's beautiful.
Radical gentleness. I love that so much. The more that I'm opening up to feeling, Philip, the more soft I am, the more gentle I am, the more caring I am, the more considerate, the more open. More soft, did I say soft? So nice. More tears are flowing freely. So beautiful. Thank you, sir. So much love.
Such a joy.
Such a joy. So thank you everybody for watching. As I always say, you are amazing for tuning in. These transparent conversations continue. I'm showing up as always and sharing and offering these as a gift. And if you'd like to also support these conversations, you can also share your gifts with me. You can become a patron of the sofa and just go to the link below and watch the video. And if you have a contribution you'd like to send my way, you can through the patronage. And whether or not you do or don't, these conversations are freely accessible for everybody. So love to you all. You're all divine miracles. And if you don't know it yet, then I hope you do soon enough. Thank you.
Amen to that.